This is one possible mode of vibration, and we call this the fundamental mode. Sometimes this is referred to as the first harmonic. If you are a musician, then one set of terms may be more familiar to you than the other. The important thing is that the length of the string is equal to one half of a wavelength. The harmonics are listed as subscripts. If you'll remember, the wave equation says that the speed of the wave on the string is equal to the wavelength times the frequency. And the speed of the wave on the string is going to be a number that's constant no matter what wavelength or frequency the string vibrates at. We can relate the harmonics and the wavelengths, the frequencies and the wavelengths of the different harmonics to each other. That's the fundamental mode. What about higher modes? There are several that are sketched in your textbook on page 568. I'm going to sketch the next three modes of vibration here. But in each case, the different modes of vibration increase by having a single antinode added to the pattern with nodes at each end of the string. In the fundamental mode, the length of the string is equal to half of the wavelength in the fundamental mode. In the first overtone, or what is also known as the second harmonic, the length of the string and the wavelength of the second overtone are the same. Here's the second overtone, or the third harmonic. 1.5 wavelengths occupies the string. Here is the third overtone, or the fourth harmonic. And you can see each time we're adding half a wave into the boundaries of this string. If you play a stringed instrument, you can cause these overtones by lightly touching the string as you pluck it or bow it, and you get a higher frequency than if the string were completely open. So now let's solve some numerical examples. Your textbook gives us a couple. Example 59.1. The fundamental frequency of a properly tuned A string on a violin is 440 hertz. Find the frequency of the second and the third harmonic. Okay, so here is a violin. The A string happens to be one of the middle strings. We're told that its frequency is 440 hertz. That length of string is going to support the second and the third harmonic. On this diagram, the length of the string goes from the nut up here to the bridge. So what I have here is a distance here I'm going to call L. And we don't know what that distance is, but what we do know is that the second harmonic and the third harmonic have to also fit in that distance L. What I know is that the first harmonic has half a wavelength in that distance L, and I know that the speed of the wave is going to be the same on this string no matter what the harmonic is. In other words, the wavelength times the frequency, the wavelength of the nth harmonic times the frequency of the nth harmonic is going to be the speed of the wave for all of the different wave patterns. Let's sketch what the second harmonic looks like. Since the length of string is equal to the wavelength, then I know that the wavelength of the second harmonic is equal to half of the wavelength of the first harmonic. Since the speeds of the various modes are going to be the same, then I can say the wavelength of the first harmonic times the frequency of the first harmonic is equal to the wavelength of the second harmonic times the frequency of the second harmonic. The second frequency is going to be lambda 1 F1 over lambda 2. So now I'm going to put in the numbers. I've substituted twice of lambda 2 in for lambda 1. Now the lambda 2's are going to go, and I see that the second frequency is going to be twice the first frequency. The frequency of the second harmonic is going to be 880 hertz. Let's do the same thing for the third harmonic. I find that the length of the string supports 1.5 wavelengths of the third harmonic. Since the length of the string for the third harmonic and the length of the string for the first harmonic are the same, then I can say that the length of the string for the first harmonic is equal to the length of the string for the second harmonic. In other words, lambda 1 is equal to 3 times lambda 3. Now let's put that into our wave equation. The speed of the wave for the first harmonic and the speed of the wave for the second harmonic are equal. So lambda 1 F1 is equal to lambda 3 F3. Solve that for F3 and then make your substitutions. I get that the third harmonic has a frequency of 1320 hertz. Here's the second example. A 0.069 meter long banjo string vibrates with a fundamental frequency of 587 hertz. What is the speed of the wave on this string? If we look at the picture of the banjo, the long strings go all the way from the bridge to the neck. That's what we would call the long string. And then for the five-string banjo, you have a short string that goes a different length right there that's shorter. That's generally plucked with the thumb. But let's say that we know what the length of the string is. It's 0.69 meters. And if it vibrates in the fundamental mode, then I know that that's going to support half a wavelength. So I can say that the wavelength of this banjo string in the fundamental mode is going to be 2 times the length of the string, or 2 times 0.69 meters. I'm told what the frequency is. The frequency of this mode is 587 hertz. Now I'm trying to figure out what's the wave speed on this string. If I know what the wavelength is and I know what the frequency is, I multiply those together to get the speed of the wave. I find that the speed of the wave on this string is 810 meters per second. So much for strings. Now we need to deal with pipes. Going along with our theme of musical instruments, I would like to draw your attention to pipes in an organ. This happens to be at Yale University. You can see that down here is the organ itself at the foot of the stage, and then over to the right is the console of this organ with several different keyboards, lots of different pedals, and a whole bunch of different stops that are allowing different pipes to be played as the organ's keyboard is pressed. And these pipes have different names and numbers. For instance, there's tuba 8, there's trumpet 8, there is piccolo 2. Each of these different pipes have a different timbre or musical quality to them, and the numbers that are there refer to the length of the pipe that happens to be playing that particular note. So the longer the pipe is, the lower the tone is going to be. What we want to do now is to take a look at standing waves inside pipes. Organs are not the only kinds of musical instruments that make use of pipes. In fact, all wind instruments make use of pipes, whether they're from the woodwind family, such as flute, clarinet, oboe, and bassoon, or the brass family, such as the trumpet, the French horn, the trombone, the tuba. I tend to think of a tenor saxophone or any kind of saxophone as a woodwind instrument because of the fact that there's a reed that plays it, but here it's classified as a brass. If you want to talk about the length of the pipes for the flute, the length of the pipe is going to be from the place where you blow across the hole, if you close all the holes, to the end. But if you open any of these holes, it could be some different distance there. For the clarinet, it goes from the mouthpiece to any of the open holes that are down being pressed by your fingers. For the oboe, it starts up here at the reed and goes to any of these open holes. For the bassoon, you have not only where the reed is, but you have this length of pipe that goes down and feeds the bottom of the bassoon, and then that length of pipe gets added to the rest of it. For these brass instruments, you can think of the length of pipe, if there are no valves pressed, as the distance of the tubing. And if any of the valves are pressed, then you can imagine adding a little length of pipe to that to make the pipe longer. So the effect of pressing valves in a brass instrument is to lengthen the pipe. And you can add different lengths of pipes depending on which valve that you press. So here for the French horn, the middle valve allows you to add a little length of pipe there. If you press the first valve, then you add a little longer pipe that's right there. If you press the third valve, then you add an even longer piece of pipe, which happens to be right here, to the total length of the instrument. And if you press combinations of valves, then you basically just add those tubings together. So if you're playing the French horn, you have the length of the tubing without any of the valves at all, and then if you press any of the valves, you actually add different lengths of tubing to the total length of the horn. What we want to do now is to look at how standing waves behave inside pipes. And there are two different classifications of pipes. They're called open pipes and closed pipes, and you need to know what the standing wave patterns look like in each of them. Our topic is standing waves in pipes. One type of pipe is called an open pipe, which means that it's open at both ends. Now, all of our pipes are going to be straight pipes, despite the curvature that's shown in these brass instruments, but we're saying that an open pipe is open at both ends, whereas a closed pipe is a pipe that is open at one end and closed on the other end. There are a couple of animations that I would like to show which illustrates the vibration of the different modes inside these different pipes. Here is an animation showing the fundamental, the first overtone, and the second overtone in these different open pipes. So I have a pipe here that has a certain length, and what I want you to see is that both ends are open and I have large vibrations at the end and I have no vibration in the middle. In other words, the condition for resonance inside an open pipe is that there are antinodes at the open ends, and that's what causes the sound to be heard loudly. So I've got an antinode in the fundamental mode, I have antinodes on each end in the second mode, and I have antinodes on each end of the third mode. We say that we have antinodes of displacement occurring at each of the open ends. That's going to help us to draw our standing wave patterns. Let's contrast this with a closed end pipe. Here's another animation. In this animation, we have the left side of the pipe closed. And you notice that there is a minimum of vibration occurring at the closed end and a maximum at the open end. What we're going to see is that this is going to determine for us the wavelengths of the standing waves that will cause resonance inside these pipes. So for a closed pipe, I have to have an antinode at the open end and a node at the closed end. Let's sketch the different standing wave patterns inside these different types of pipes. Let me make observation here, which is that sound waves are longitudinal, but longitudinal waves are not as easy to draw as transverse waves are. So for the purposes of sketching, we're going to show transverse waves inside these different pipes, but recognize that it's sound. Sound is a longitudinal wave. Let's begin with the open pipes. Here I have a tube that has an opening at both ends, and it has a length L to it. Now, what I want to do is I want to put a standing wave inside this pipe in such a way that I have antinodes at each end. How can I do that? Here's a pattern, the longest pattern that will fit in there that causes that to happen. Over here to the right, I've sketched a standing wave, and to get from one antinode to the next antinode, then this pattern that is between those red marks there is the longest pattern that will fit inside this pipe. So that's the pattern that I've got to sketch inside my open pipe for the fundamental mode. And what I see is that I have sketched a half of a wavelength in here. In other words, lambda 1 over 2 is equal to the length of the pipe for the fundamental mode. Now let's take this same pipe, and if we're a wind player, say with a flute or with a trumpet, if I blow just a little bit harder, I can get a higher pitch. What kind of pattern will appear next? Well, let's add half a wavelength. Still, we've got to have a antinode at each end of the pipe. Here's what the pattern's going to look like. This next harmonic has that the length of the pipe is equal to one wavelength of the wave. I can see that I have half of a wavelength in the middle of the pipe, and I have a quarter wavelength on each end of the pipe. So when I add all that together, I get a full wavelength. One more, and then we'll move on to the closed pipes. So again, here's my same pipe of length L. Let me blow a little bit harder, and I'll get another standing wave pattern that produces an even higher pitch. And now I see I have 1.5 wavelengths inside this pipe for the next harmonic that's there. Here is a half of a wavelength. There's another half of a wavelength. So that adds up to one wavelength. And then at the ends, I have a quarter wavelength. So from here to here is 1/4 of a wavelength. And from there to there is 1/4 of a wavelength. So when I add all that up, what I'm going to find is I have 1.5 wavelengths inside that pipe. This is for the open pipes.